See you. Jesus is calling. Have you come to the end of yourself?
Mary cross as you wait for the crown.
treasure you found.
Well, hey there, everyone. My name's Brady. Welcome to Bonita Valley, and thanks for spending part of your weekend with us. If it's your first time, we invite you to sit back, relax, and enjoy the service. We'd like to take a few minutes and tell you about some things coming up for you and your family around BVCC. So, check this out.
Bonita Valley is excited for a new season of life-changing ministry for you and your family. We believe the best way to grow in your walk with God is to surround yourself with real and meaningful relationships. And that's why we value our weekly ministries here at BVCC. Primetimers is back in action and meets this Tuesday at 10 a.m. MOPS, Mothers of Preschoolers, meets this Wednesday at 9:15 a.m. Breakthrough Prayer Night opens its doors for a time of prayer and worship beginning Monday, August 16th at 7 p.m. And our I Am Entitled Youth Ministry makes its return with weekly events beginning Wednesday, August 18th at 6:30 p.m. For more information on these opportunities and so many more, visit us at bonitavalley.com.
Wouldn't it be great if we had a place to give focused time and attention to our kids who are struggling? A place where we could offer support and encouragement, pray with them, and teach them skills to cope with their life circumstances? And wouldn't it truly be a dream come true if there was a safe place for struggling parents too? Well, Confident Kids and Parents is that place. CK Kids have their own class focused on their needs, while CK Parents attend a class tailor-made for parenting. During this next session titled Making Wise Choices, children and their parents learn a six-step process for making wise choices and how to find support when they need to ask for help. Our next session begins August 3rd at 7 p.m. To register, visit bonitavalley.com, the Events tab, and select Confident Kids and Parents.
Our ministry to men and women begin brand new Bible studies this August, with the ladies focusing on a study about gaining victory in our minds entitled, Get Out of Your Head. Our men's group begins their fall season with a series on changing the narrative in our life entitled, Don't Give the Enemy a Seat at Your Table. Both groups begin Thursday, August 12th, with the ladies offering two meeting times at 10 a.m. and 6:30 p.m., and the men offering their evening study at 6:30 p.m.
Bonita Valley loves young adults, and that's why we've created a space for college-age students and 20-somethings to know God and be known by others. That space is called Collage. Collage is all about growing in our relationship with God and just having fun together. We believe that the best way to grow in your walk with God is to surround yourself with real and meaningful relationships. Our next Collage event happens Friday, August 13th at 7 p.m. in the Family Center. For more information, you can follow us at CollageBVCC on Instagram.
Connecting at BVCC is easier now than ever with our online Connect card. Here's how it works. Scan the QR code you'll find at the Info Center, Guest Central, or various other locations around the campus with the camera on your smartphone. Open the link that will take you to Connect Card. You'll see a number of connecting options, including first-time guest, prayer requests. I committed my life to Jesus today. I want more info on a Bonita Valley ministry. Check the appropriate connection box you're after, push submit, and we'll get back to you ASAP. At BVCC, we're all about making connections with God and others. And if you are a first-time guest today, please stop by Guest Central at the end of this service and pick up the gift bag we have just for you. Biblically speaking, we're managers, not owners, of everything God has entrusted to us, our time, talents, and treasures. God wants us to leverage our temporary resources to make an eternal and life-changing difference, which is what giving at BVCC is all about. Your faithful giving to the Lord through Bonita Valley is transforming lives, others, and ours. There are three ways to give at BVCC. online at bonitavalley.com/giving, by texting Bonita Valley to 833-303-9325, or by mailing your offering to BVCC 4744 Bonita Road, Bonita, California, 91902.
September 26, 1987, my wife Joni and I were married. In Eastern Washington, Richland, Washington, beautiful, drier part of the state of Washington. When we got married, it was on a Saturday, but the night before, after the rehearsal dinner, my groomsman grabbed me, stripped me down to a loincloth, duct taped my ankles, duct taped my wrists, my wrists and my ankles, put me on a pole, and they carried me across the street to the Catholic Church, which was hosting, here's the picture right here, which was hosting one of the third largest annual event in the Tri-Cities area. There was a couple thousand people there. They were going to blindfold me. I said, nope, if I'm going to do this, I want to see the faces of people as you're walking me through this crowd. It was embarrassing. Next thing they wanted to do was to, when they finished with that, was they wanted to throw me in the Columbia River, which is like one of the biggest rivers west of the Mississippi, right? And my mom stopped that from happening. She intervened. She said, you can't do that. He's going to sing the Joni tomorrow when she's walking down the aisle. You can't throw him in the river. He's had laryngitis all week long. And she saved the day, and I survived and was able the next day to stand up there with my mustache, my permed mullet, and I was able to sing to my bride as she walked down the aisle that Kenny Rogers song. And no, it wasn't You Gotta Know When to Hold 'Em, Know When to Fold 'Em. It wasn't that song. It was a song called Crazy. And it was a beautiful moment of her walking down the aisle and me being able to sing to her. We stood at the altar. We stated our vows. We said, I do. And from that moment on, the two storylines of our lives have been one for almost 34 years next month, right? Going somewhere with this. So we went on our honeymoon to Maui. Anybody been to Maui? Beautiful Hawaiian island. We went to Maui for our honeymoon. Had an amazing time, an unforgettable time. And it was also at that island experience where I thought I was going to lose my wife 4 days into our marriage. No joke. You know when you go to a tropical island like that and the water's so warm and the air just kind of caresses and kisses your skin as you're there, right? And we wanted to have one of those romantic, stand in the water, hand in hand kind of moments. You know how that is. You just picture yourself. Come on, picture yourself. That's Napili Bay. This is where we stayed. So just imagine yourself just standing there. It's beautiful. It's tropical. Everything is wonderful. And it was, right up until the moment when a huge wave came and ripped her hand out of my hand, threw us both underwater, and we kind of washing machined around for a little bit, and we came up. And I tried to get to her, and right before I was able to grab her hand again, another wave came and crashed into us and just pounded us into the surf and washing machined us around again, and we stood up again. And it happened literally 3 or 4 different times. You know those thoughts when it's kind of slow motion going through your head going, okay, this is not good. And in my mind, I'm thinking, I am not losing my wife 4 days into this thing, because I literally could not get to her. The surf was that rough. And then out of nowhere, with perfect form, she caught the next wave and actually body surfed all the way to the shore. It was amazing. And here we were. We're lying on the beach like two beached dolphins. We're covered in sand. We're exhausted. We're embarrassed. And one of the local guys comes walking over to check on us, and he watched the whole thing happen, and he asked us, he said, are you guys okay? And we said we were. And then he said something I will never forget. He looked at us and said, do you know why none of the locals are in the ocean right now, only tourists? He pointed to a sign, big sign with big letters that said, high surf warning. And it was a warning really to not go in the water. And we just were so in love. It's romantic. We walked right past it. Of course, it didn't apply to us. We're going to go have our moment in the ocean. Little did we know that way off the coast, because there's no Google, there's no phone app, there's no weather app telling us that way off the coast, there's a hurricane, right, that's kicking up these crazy big waves like you saw in the picture there. And it was an amazing moment, and that moment happened 34 years ago next month. And ever since that moment, life has been trying to throw wave after wave at us to try to pull us apart. In 2003, we both were diagnosed in the summer of 2003 with cancer, went through our different treatments. In 2020, we both went through partial knee replacement surgeries together. In 2021, earlier this year in January, we both tested positive for COVID on the same day. By the way, we do everything together. We do. We both have suffered different kinds of loss in our lives. Her a little bit more, and even more so, especially when the Seahawks lost to the Patriots in the Super Bowl. We had to navigate through that moment. She grew up as a Seahawks fan. And I didn't know who she was going to vote for, but she's a full disciple right now. She is full thrown, bought into the Patriots, and that's who she is. I don't know if my marriage could survive if that wasn't the case, but she is. And we've walked through life together wave after wave. Come on, if you've been married for longer than a day, those words, for better or for worse, for richer or for poor, in sickness and in health, have touched your life at one point or another, in one way or another. And you know as well as I do that those are moments that not only can mark you and mark your marriage, but they can also take a toll on your marriage as well. I mean, come on, think about it. You think about a marriage relationship. You think about the struggles that we have to walk through, the tensions that are there. Think about the financial stress. Think about those moments in our life where we have to navigate through the different family emotional changes that happen. You know, when the babies are first born, your whole world has just changed overnight, right? Go from two to babies in the house, or at least one baby, unless you have twins or triplets or whatever. You know, you've got people other than the two of you in the house, and you're having to navigate through that. And then they go off to preschool and then to grade school, and then you walk through the tumultuous teen years, and then there's that whole empty nest thing you got to navigate through, and you're excited in a different way, right? You're walking through that. There's different parts of family life that we go through that we have to navigate through, along with sicknesses and struggles and things like that in a normal life in marriage. Throw on top of that a pandemic, and it goes to a whole different level of crazy. Come on, it really does when we have to navigate through all of those things. But when those moments happen, they have happened, and you know as well as I do that they will come again. But when they do, one of the most important things that you can do and that I can do to keep ourselves from being pulled apart relationally is to choose this principle that we've been talking about choosing to think we instead of me. See, it is this powerful truth that once we embrace it, once we live it, once we understand the power of it, we can find ourselves coming to a place where we can step into the power of what this principle is all about. You ever wondered how it is that two people madly in love can all of a sudden grow apart? Or how a close family can suddenly become polarized by division and anger? How you can have a super talented team, yet they struggle to win together as a team. Or you can find yourself in a place where a close friendship is torn apart by disagreement, or even trying to figure out why is it that it seems like maintaining healthy relationships seems like it is a constant struggle all the time, no matter what kind of relationship you have with somebody. It takes work, it takes effort. If you've ever wondered why to any of those questions that I just asked, all you have to do for the answer is to go back to the beginning of the story. If you have your Bibles, I want to invite you to turn to Genesis chapter 2, or you can click on the follow the service link. And I want us to look at a passage of scripture that, if your wedding was like our wedding, then this passage, which is a familiar passage, was part of your wedding ceremony. It's a powerful passage because it's the beginning of the story. It's a powerful picture that helps us understand why we navigate through the relational struggles and the relational issues that we find ourselves walking through. But I want to say right from the very beginning here that this is not a message just for married couples. This is for all of us. Anyone who has any kind of relationship, this is a message that we get to lean into because this truth right here can help us. One of COVID's biggest impacts has been on relationships. And that's the reason why this relational principle that we're talking about is not only so powerful, but it is so needed for such a time as this in all of our lives and in all of our relationships. Last week, we kicked off this little mini two-part series, and we talked about how this relational principle is one that if we choose to embrace it, it can not only shift the atmosphere in a marriage, It can also bring us to a place where it can end a standoff that we may be having in a relationship with somebody. It can change the toxic culture in a workplace or on a team. It's the heart posture that we need for the Holy Spirit to break into those places in our life that we need to heal, grow, and recover. It is a simple yet profound principle that has absolute powerful implications, not only in our life, but also in the lives of other people around us as well, that happen every single time we choose to do this one thing. And it's the big idea for this series. We talked about it last week. It is just simply when we choose to think we, not me. I want us to go Genesis 2. Let's pick it up in verse 18. It says, "And then the Lord said, it is not good for man to be alone." Now, can I get an amen from the men in this room right now? Yeah, that's just as weak as it was in the first service. It is not good for the man to be alone. Can I hear an amen out there for all the men? Unless you want to be alone. That's another conversation altogether. But it was God who said, it's not good for man to be alone. He recognized that. So he said, "I will make a helper who is just right for him." So the Lord God formed from the ground all the wild animals, all the birds of the sky. He brought them to the man to see what he would call them. And the man chose a name for each one. And he gave names to all the livestock. After the fall of man, they would become affectionately known as Taco, Big Mac, and Whopper. He named them all. All the birds of the sky, all the wild animals. But still, there was no helper just right for him. So the Lord God caused the man to fall into a deep sleep. While the man slept, listen, ladies, come on, when your man's taking a nap, that's when God can do some of his deepest work in his life. The Lord took out one of the man's ribs while he was sleeping, and he closed up the opening. And then the Lord God made a woman from the rib, and he brought her to the man. And I love this, verse 23, where it says two words, "at last." At last. Last. I love that. In fact, one of my favorite moments in any wedding that I do is this moment. It's the moment when the groom sees his bride walking down the aisle for the first time, and his eyes are locked with her eyes, and there's this moment, you can see it, because as he's looking at her, I'm looking at him, because I love to watch the eyes of what's happening, and you can see it in his eyes. It's like, at last, this is the moment. And that was Adam's experience. He said, "At last, this one is bone from my bone and flesh from my flesh, and she will be called woman because she was taken from man." Think about that moment. God had created these amazing animals. All you have to do is go to the San Diego Zoo. You look and you see these amazing different creatures that God has created. And I've always wondered what they looked like before the fall of man, right? Did they look more beautiful? Did they stink before sin came into the world or not? I don't know. That's one of those questions that's on my list, way down the list of questions that I have, but it's still on my list of questions that I love to ask God. What did it look like? What did they look like? All I know is that here's this moment where Adam is seeing these amazing animals created, some of them that will one day be on the front cover. They'd be the model for future animal crackers. These are the things that God is creating that he's getting to name, right? They're beautiful. They're amazing. But yet, here's this moment when he sees Eve for the first time. He says, "At last, this one, this is the beauty that I've been waiting for." Come on, ladies. Every bride wants that to be the response of her man as he sees her walking down that aisle, where he looks at you and he says, "At last," which is so much better than, "Oh, snap," right? Come on. You want to hear, "At last." It's such a beautiful moment. And then verse 24, it says, "And this explains why a man leaves his father and mother and is joined to his wife, and the two are united into what? Into one." The two who are me all of a sudden go from me to we. And then verse 25 says, "Now the man and his wife were both naked, and they felt no shame." You can say that for Adam and Eve in this moment right now in their relationship, they had perfect attunement. Attunement simply means alignment. It means to be in sync with. They were in sync with each other spiritually, relationally, emotionally. Come on. There was no shame. There were no insecurities. No one's asking the question, does this fig leaf make me look fat? There's nothing of that there, right? It's a beautiful, synchronized relationship, which is exactly the way that God designed it to be. It's the picture of relationship at its most intimate level. See, God designed the marriage relationship between a husband and a wife to be deeper, more intimate, more personal, more fulfilling than any other relationship. And at the end of chapter 2, Genesis chapter 2, that's exactly what we see taking place. There's life, there's love, there's relationship, there's attunement, there's unity that they have. They are in sync with each other the way that a marriage was meant to be in sync. That was the perfect moment in Genesis chapter 2 until everything changed in chapter 3. See, chapter 3, and you know this, is when Adam and Eve made a decision that not only affected their relationship with God, that when they chose to disobey God, not only did it affect their relationship with God, not only did it affect their relationship with one another, but it has rippled through every generation and would impact every relationship ever formed at any time on this planet. And it was all because Adam and Eve, in that moment, when they chose to disobey God, they made a decision in that moment to choose and to think me instead of we. It was the ultimate me instead of we moment in history. And every issue that we struggle with today, every issue that tears at your marriage or my marriage, your family or my family, your friendships or my friendships, every issue that we contend with in any relationship that you have, any relationship that I have, even our ability to connect with other people can be traced back to this moment in Genesis chapter 3 when Adam and Eve chose me instead of we. Isn't it amazing? One decision forever changed the history of this planet. One choice to pick me instead of we, and it affected everything. That's the reason why it is that a couple that starts off on their wedding day as we can wake up one day and all of a sudden it's become all about me. That we time is now all about me time. That when it comes to how I spend my money, maybe there was a time where we focused together as a couple and we spent our money and it was all about what was best for we, but then we can find ourselves drifting over to where all of a sudden we want to buy what's best for me. It's the gravitational pull. See, the gravitational pull in any relationship is always from we to me. See, when we find ourselves in a relationship, choosing we over me is always a choice, but the gravitational pull is always trying to pull us away from we so that we can live by ourselves on planet me, right? And you know how it happens? It happens very subtly, it happens slowly, and it happens one wave at a time. 2015, our family flew down here for Joni's brother who got married on Silver Strand Beach. It was a beautiful trip. We were here for several days. In fact, it was interesting because as we drove around, went to the zoo, see, we did all the stuff that you do when you come to San Diego. We had such a great time. I'll never forget Joni making a statement. She says, you know, I think I'd kind of like to live here. I think it would be great. And I'm looking at her going, are you out of your mind? You know how expensive California is? You know, one of those things, right? But who knew that a year and a half early, God was giving us a sneak peek of what was coming in February of 2017 with us moving here, right? So it was great to be able to get a taste of that and to experience that. And we stayed a couple nights over at Lowe's. It was a great experience. And Silver Strand, even to this day, is our favorite beach that we enjoy when we go to. One of the beach days that we had when we were there, Joni and I, we're sitting on the beach, toes in the sand, and our two sons, Tyler and Josh, are in the water doing their boogie board thing. It was perfect weather. The waves were perfect. They're doing their thing. You got to understand, they grew up in the desert, all right? There's no waves in the desert. And they're out there doing their boogie board thing. And it was interesting to watch where they started, and literally in a few minutes, all of a sudden they found themselves that they had drifted 70 yards up the beach. They didn't even realize that one wave at a time, that the current was pulling them away from where they had originally started. See, the same thing happens in your marriage and in my marriage. It happens in your relationships. It happens in any relationship where the gravitational pull from we to me, it happens one wave at a time. It happens slowly. It happens subtly. It happens when we choose me instead of we. It's the reason why we can find ourselves in a place where there are gaps that seem to separate us relationally where there weren't there before. And you can imagine that when you look at those gaps and you look at what's unfolding in your life, what's at work, and a lot of times we don't even realize this, that what's at work is this principle of the shift and the gravitational pull of moving from we to me. Come on, think about this. Trace the tension that's happening in your marriage right now. Trace the tension that may be there in your relationship with your kids right now, or with a parent right now, or in your workplace with coworkers right now, or on a team that you may be a part of, anywhere that you have tension in a relationship. Trace the tension in those relationships. And I would bet, I would say that if you trace those tension points in those relationships, that what you're going to find is at the root of those tension points in any of those relationships, I believe what you'll come to is that somewhere in the relationship, somewhere, someone is thinking me instead of we. And it affects everything because it changes the culture of our relationships. That's why this principle of thinking we, not me, is so powerful. Because when we carry this principle in our heart of thinking we, not me, it shapes the culture of our relationships. Because what we carry in our heart always shapes the culture of any relationship that we step into. Listen, if my life is all about me, it's going to affect my relationships. If my life is all about we, it's going to affect my relationships, and the same thing is true for you as well. Your marriage right now, the culture of your marriage right now, is being shaped by the attitudes that you're carrying in your own heart. The relationship you have with your family members, in your workplace when you show up, you are helping to shape the environment and the culture of those relationships and where they're lived and where they're played out simply by the attitudes that you carry in your heart and the attitudes that I carry in my heart. So here's my question. If that's true, if the gravitational pull is always from we to me, then the question that I have is if living for me opens up the door for our relationships to experience tension, disagreement, hurt, pain, struggles, then the question that we need to address and the question we need to come to then is how do we stop the drift toward me and make the shift to thinking we? I want to give you two ways this morning, two handles. Now, I realize that the Bible is full of principles and truths that we can lean into and hold on to. I want us to look at two handles that if we embrace these, I believe they can help us to live out our life in a way in our relationships to where we can more often continue to think we and not me. And anytime we choose to live by that principle, I'm telling you, friends, it brings life and harmony into the relationships that we are in. The first thing is this. If we're going to think we, not me, the first thing that it takes is it takes extreme ownership. It takes extreme ownership. See, we can talk about thinking we, not me, all day long, but it only happens when you and I make a choice to own it. We have to choose to own it, and it takes extreme ownership for that to happen. I'm reading a fascinating book right now written by a couple former Navy SEALs. In fact, the title of it is Extreme Ownership. And it's all about how the U.S. Navy SEALs lead and win. I know we've got several former Navy SEALs who are part of our church, and maybe you're here today and you're a SEAL. I haven't had a chance to meet you yet. Whether you are a former SEAL or active duty SEAL, we just thank you for your service. So glad you're a part of our church family. This is an interesting book that I'm reading through right now because it's helping me to understand. I don't really have a military background per se. My dad was in the Army. I had a grandfather who was in the Coast Guard. And all I know is that I'm in the Lord's Army. You know, that's like you are as well. And that's where we're at. But that's the extent of my military experience that's there. So when I'm reading a book like this, it helps me to just read through the anecdotal stories and to understand better what the Navy SEALs are all about. And they talk about how in the book that Navy SEALs are trained to endure the extreme circumstances that they faced, to endure extreme conditions, to do extreme things, all because of a willingness of each SEAL member to commit to extreme ownership. See, the biggest takeaway in the book is when the authors talk about how extreme ownership is about taking ownership of every area in their life as Navy SEALs, where they're willing to acknowledge mistakes, they're willing to admit failure, they're willing to take ownership of those things and then come up with a plan so that not only do they learn from it, but so that it never happens again. It really is a fascinating book to read through, and it's all about how to lead and win based on extreme ownership. Do you know that the Apostle Paul also talked about extreme ownership? In what is one of the most recognized, memorized chapters in the Bible, where he shows us not necessarily, well, he does. He shows us what the Navy SEAL is. They show us how to lead and win. The Apostle Paul shows us how to love and win. And it's when you look at 1 Corinthians chapter 13, come on, as soon as you mention 1 Corinthians 13, you've got roses and heart emojis that are going through your head right now, because we think of 1 Corinthians 13, that's the love chapter, that's the Valentine's chapter, right? Come on, that's the cross stitch on the wall, or the meme, or the Instagram shot. You know, those are the verses that we put on this 1 Corinthians 13. It is so beautiful, it is so wonderful. Until you realize that when you take a closer look at it, that right in the middle of it, there are four verses. And those are four verses that, yes, they are built around love, but in order to live them out, takes extreme ownership. Especially in the culture that you and I are living in today. So here's the question I want you to ask yourself as we read through these four verses in a moment. The easiest thing to do, and we're so good at this, the easiest thing to do is to take this list of values that we're going to look at and put it side by side with our spouse, measure our spouse, right? Or by a friend, or, you know, measure a friend that we maybe are having a struggle with our relationship with, or we pull it out and how our parents are measuring up to it, how our kids are measuring up to it, and how our coworkers are measuring up to it. But what I want you to do in this moment right now, as we look at and read through these verses and these values, I want to challenge you to ask this question as we do. How am I owning these verses, these values being lived out in my life right now? How am I owning, living these verses and these values in my marriage right now, in my relationship with my family right now, with my friendships right now, with my co-workers right now? How am I owning, am I taking ownership of these verses and these values in my life right now? And here's what the Apostle Paul wrote, 1 Corinthians 13, beginning in verse 4, he says this. Love is patient. Let's just stop right there. How many of you, like me, three words into this list, you've already failed? Come on, it's patience is a constant construction zone in my life. And it's like, okay, I quit already. Love is patient. Love is kind. It does not envy. It does not boast. It is not proud. It does not dishonor others. It is not self-seeking. It is not easily angered. It keeps no record of wrongs. Love does not delight in evil, but rejoices with the truth, which is the exact opposite of what's happening so much in our culture today. It always protects, always trusts, always hopes, always perseveres. And say this with me, love never fails. Come on, these are the verses that look so beautiful, cross-stitched on your grandmother's pillow that you remember as a kid, right? But yet, when you look at these verses, all of a sudden you realize that these beautiful verses also take extreme ownership to live them out. I don't know how many times I've read this passage, but all I know is that there is no possible way that I can live out these verses consistently unless the Holy Spirit breaks in and enlarges my heart and gives me a greater capacity to love, to forgive, and to live out these verses, because my heart right now, it's not big enough. I need help to do that. I need the Holy Spirit to enlarge my heart for that to happen. Listen, I can blow half this list just driving to Ralph's to go buy groceries. Come on. When you think about this list, and you think about what it takes to live out these verses, my heart's not big enough to do this on a regular basis. Secretariat was a Triple Crown champion horse, one of the greatest horses that has ever run. In fact, still today owns the top three fastest times in all the three Triple Crown races. And it's just a powerful horse, one of the greatest racehorses of all time. I don't know if you knew that Secretariat's heart, it said that the heart of Secretariat was three times the size of an average horse's heart. And it actually weighed 22 pounds. What would happen if our capacity to love, our capacity to forgive, our capacity to value others, like we just read about in those verses, tripled in size? What would happen if the prayer of our heart was, God, enlarge my heart, help me to love bigger, to give bigger, to forgive bigger and faster? Help me to value people bigger. What if the prayer of our heart was what David wrote about in Psalm 119, verse 32, when he said these words? He said, I will run the course of your commandments, for you shall, what? You shall enlarge my heart. You know what David's saying? David is saying to God, he's saying, the only way that I can follow your words and your ways is going to be by you enlarging my heart. The only way that I know for myself that I can follow the words and ways that are listed in 1 Corinthians 13 is if God enlarges my heart. And the way that we can think we, not me, is the willingness to take ownership of this, to realize, God, I can't do this. I need your help. And the only way that I can take ownership of my relationships, to own those places in my life that I need to own, so that I show up as a father, I show up as a husband, I show up as a pastor, and I show up as a friend, the only way that happens is if I'm willing to take ownership, extreme ownership, so that I can continue to think we and not me. But not only that, there's one more. That not only does it take extreme ownership, the second thing that it takes is it takes a next step. If we want to think we, not me, it takes a next step. It never happens by accident. Thinking we, not me, never happens by accident. You've heard us talk about before a lot, actually, where we talk about how information plus application is what leads to transformation. You know what information is? It's what we just did when we read through those verses that were on the screen. That's information. The Apostle Paul has given us information about love, what love is and what love is not. Application is when you and I look at those verses, we get alone with God, and we ask God, show me where I need to grow up in the area of these verses that we just read. Show me the places in my life where I need to take a next step so that as I apply that step to my life, that information about how to love that can be combined with application of it in my life that can lead to transformation in my relationships. It never happens by accident. No one ever stumbles into a thriving marriage. No one ever stumbles into thriving friendships or thriving relationships of any kind. It happens one decision at a time. Every time you and I in our relationships make the decision to take ownership and to take the next step so that every day we are doing our best to just keep thinking we, not me. I want to ask you a question. When it comes to the relationships in your life right now, what relationship in your life right now needs you to step up and to take ownership of? Just let that hang there for a moment. It's uncomfortable. It's awkward. We want to go get our holy paletas on outside right now, right? No, it's an honest question. What relationship in my life, what relationship in your life needs me to step up and to take ownership of? Let me put it a different way. What relationship in your life right now needs attention? Maybe it's your marriage. And this last year and a half has been incredibly difficult for marriages, and we can find ourselves at each other's throats because that's what happens when we navigate through life. And we can find ourselves, you may find yourself as a married couple right now sitting next to each other geographically, and yet not even recognize that you are 70 yards apart emotionally. And it happens one moment at a time. But what would happen if we recognize the importance of our marriage and we just made a decision, say, you know what? I need to give proper attention to my marriage right now. I need to start thinking we, not me, because it's so easy to think me. Come on, it's so easy. When it comes to finances, I can think me, very easy. But what if we choose to think we, not me? What if in order to get my we on in my marriage and you do the same with yours, that we time also involves some woo time? Come on, you know what I'm talking about, that we have to woo our spouse. I know it doesn't sound masculine or manly, but it has great benefits. Come on, so you gotta woo your spouse, right? You've got to do that. What would it look like to bring some attention to the marriage and put another log on the fire of passion, or to create some date space so that you can focus on we, not me? Listen, life is constantly like the waves that pulled Jonah and I apart. That's life, and it's trying to pull us apart so that we live under the same roof, but yet God wants the marriage relationship to thrive. What part of your marriage needs your attention right now? Or maybe it's your relationship with your kids. Life happens. And our time gets swallowed up by so many different things. I was reminded of that on Friday. Our oldest son lives in Seattle. In the last two Fridays, right in the middle of the day, right in the middle of major sermon prep, he called. And he's just calling to check in, just calling to say hi. And what are you doing? Working on a sermon. You know, I'm in study mode right now. And it just brought back a reminder, because way too many times, when I look back over the 17 years of pastoring in Las Vegas, preparing a message every week, how many times, especially when my boys are younger, I have regret that I've had to process through, because I was so dialed in to putting together that message that I missed those moments with my boys that I have to engage in and remember to engage in now. And don't get me wrong. I'm not saying throw priorities aside. What I'm saying is we have to learn to navigate through the priorities and to manage our time so that we can give the very best at our jobs and what we do for a living, but also we can invest the best into those relationships as well. And maybe for you right now, your next step is to grab that baseball mitt and a ball or a football and just go out in the front yard or go out in the street or go wherever you need to go and just begin to create some space and some time with your kids. Or maybe it's a close friendship that you had that was super close before COVID, and somehow you lost connection, and now's just the time for you to just pick up the phone, to make the connection, to reconnect, because the relationship matters too much. What relationship? What's your next step in your relationship that needs your attention right now? Not only that, here's another question for you. What relationship needs to be repaired? See, these are the ones we'd rather steer away from. But what's your next step in that relationship that you don't even have to think about, but you know it because it's broken? Where in your life right now has the Holy Spirit been poking and putting his finger on because he wants to heal that broken relationship that you're navigating through right now? And that if you let him, he will. Maybe the next step for you is to simply come before God and say, God, I need you to enlarge my heart with this person because I can't do it on my own. I can't love them the way that I need to love them. I can't forgive them the way that I need to forgive them. I can't ask forgiveness the way that I know that I need to. I need you to enlarge my heart and give me a greater capacity to do so. Where in your life is the Holy Spirit saying, I want to heal this broken relationship? And he wants you to own it. Maybe it's in your life in a relationship where, remember that part of the verse where it said, love keeps no record of wrongs? And yet you've got a whole synchronized list where you've got a direct category. You push a button and it just pulls up a list of offenses and a list of things that are happened. Come on, it's so easy. We can do it without even realizing we're doing it. It's second nature. We pull our phone out. We timestamp it. They did this. They said it here. This is when it was. And boom, it's right there. We have instant recall with that. And yet love, which takes extreme ownership, keeps no record of wrong. What relationship in your life right now do you need to take a next step in because it needs to be repaired, that God wants to heal? But not only that, one more question. What relationship in your life needs to be initiated? What relationship in your life needs to be initiated? Where do you need to take a next step? See, for you, maybe your next step is when it comes to thinking we, not me, is to find your we, right? Now think about that. I know it's a kind of a corny play of words, but think about this. Your next step may be to realize that I've been doing life alone. And the Christian life was never designed to live life alone. It was meant to happen in the context of relationships. You've heard me mention this many times before, and Pastor Jeff as well, that there's 59 one another's in the New Testament that can only be lived out in the context of relationships. You see, we need others because we grow best with others. We need friends that make the difference when life gets real. Two are better than one, because if one falls down, then another is there to help pick them up, and a cord of three strands is not easily broken. And even Jesus himself said that where two or more gather together in my name, I'm right there with them. He was all about community. So my question for you today is just simply this. Who are your people? Pastor Jeff asked a couple weeks ago in his last message of It's Go Time, he asked this question. He said, who's on your team? And I would ask that same question today. Who's on your team? Who's in your tribe? Or we live in a Navy town. Who's part of your crew? Part of your life? Who are you doing life with? You see, we care about people getting connected in here at Bonita. And that's why on August 25th, I want to invite you out. That one of the best ways to get connected is we're gonna host a night to give people an opportunity to find out more about connecting environments here at the church. You're also going to have an opportunity to kick the tires. And you're also going to have an opportunity to hear more about how to start a small group, how to find a crew, start a crew, and if you spend enough time together, maybe one day you'll actually go on a cruise together because of the depth of relationship. Come on, how many know that God not only wants us to do life together so that we can grow, but that we can do it having a blast as well? But it never happens by accident. We have to initiate. We have to step into those environments. Where in your life do you need to take a next step to find your we? We want to help you do that. See, when it comes to healthy relationships, they never happen by accident. We have to find them. We have to start them. We have to initiate them. We have to cultivate them. And the way that we cultivate them is the only way that they start is if we're willing to look past me and to start thinking we, because we realize I need other people in my life. But it takes two things if we're going to think we, not me. We talked about it a moment ago. First of all, it takes extreme ownership. Where in your life right now is God asking you to step up and to step into that relationship that you're in right now and to own some things that you need to own? Maybe it's the way that you are loving right now or not loving that you need to own. Maybe it's the part about being easily angry that you need to own, or the part about holding on to records that you need to own. Whatever it is, it's realizing, God, I can't do this unless I take ownership. And the only way that I can take extreme ownership of this is if you enlarge my heart. I need you to enlarge my heart. It takes extreme ownership for that to happen. But not only that, it also takes a next step. What is the next step that you need to take in your life when it pertains to your relationships? What relationship needs your attention? What relationship needs to be repaired that God wants to heal? What relationship do you need to initiate? See, once again, this principle, this relational principle, that if we will choose to embrace it, I promise you, if we will choose to embrace it, it can shift the atmosphere in our marriage. It can end the stalemate of a standoff that we have with someone that we're in relationship with, a struggle that's happening in our life. It can change the toxic culture of a workplace or a team. It can open up our heart and allow the Holy Spirit to heal, grow, recover those places in our life where we need it. It is a simple yet profound principle that has unbelievable implications that unfold not only in our life but in the lives of other people around if we are willing to choose to do this one thing. And it's just simply to choose to think we and not me. Would you bow your heads with me this morning as we close? Father, here today, you are all about relationships. You're about healthy relationships, first and foremost with you. And that's where it begins. Life is all about relationships, and healthy relationships flow out of a healthy, growing, thriving relationship with you. So that really is the starting point here today. God, would you help us that as we lean into you and we cultivate our relationship with you, would you give us the ability to cultivate healthy relationships in our own life? God, show us those places in our life where we need to take ownership, and in some cases, extreme ownership, where we need to show up and to step in. Help us, God. Enlarge our hearts. Give us the capacity to love the way that you love. Help us to own it as we do. God, give us the courage to take the next step that we need to take so that we can engage and initiate and give attention to and to build and to grow healthy relationships. God, it never happens by accident. So that's why we're praying today, welcoming you and inviting you into our hearts, because what we carry in our hearts will shape the culture of our relationships. So we want to carry your words and your ways. God, I pray today that you would heal marriages that are hurting and broken right now. Restore moms and dads in their relationship with their kids. Kids in their relationship with their parents. Relationships with siblings. Relationships with coworkers. Relationships with neighbors. Whatever the relationship is, Jesus, break in. Enlarge our hearts and help us to live the way that you lived, in Jesus' name. If you're here today and you've never opened up your heart to Jesus, it really is the starting point to healthy, thriving relationships. It begins with him. And you can enter into that relationship by praying this simple prayer. You can repeat it after me. Dear Jesus, would you come into my life right now? Forgive me of my sins. I have made a mess of my life, of my relationships. That's why I need you to be my Lord and to be my Savior. I welcome you into my life today. Lead me, guide me. Let the strongest relationship in my life be my relationship with you. And it's in your name, Jesus, I pray. Amen.